Hi, welcome to .NETrix YouTube channel and welcome to my course ASP.NET Core Interview Question and Answer. My name is Shalin Chauhan. I am Microsoft MVP, Technical Consultant and Corporate Trainer. In this course, I have prepared a common set of interview question answer which are going to be asked commonly in any ASP.NET Core interview. So here we learn the interview question answer about HTML helpers, caching, bundling and minification. You will learn here the interview question answer about inversion of control and the dependency. You will learn about the interview question answer about filters. So these are the set of question answer I prepared for you so that you will get to know how to give the answer regarding all these topics in your next ASP.NET Core interview. If you are coming to this channel first time, I request you to please do subscribe to .NETrix YouTube channel so that the information about such valuable content you will get notified. I hope you will join me in this journey to prepare you for your ASP.NET Core interview. So let's get started. Question answer about helpers. So what are the helpers? So helpers are similar to the ASP.NET MVC 5. So ASP.NET Core also support the HTML helpers, which are similar to the ASP.NET server controls. If you are having the understanding of ASP.NET web form, if you don't have, don't worry. Just think about HTML helpers as a way to create the input controls. And in ASP.NET Core, these are the extension method of HTML helper class or iHTML helper interface. In MVC 5, we having the HTML helper class, these extension method they are considered. But in ASP.NET Core, they become the extension method of iHTML helper interface also. So this is a difference you will find out in ASP.NET Core. And the objective of HTML helpers is to create the input controls. So obviously they return the HTML markup to us so that we can create the text box, drop down list, checkbox and various others forms input control. And even you can create your own HTML helpers as well. Sometimes it happens you are willing to create your own custom HTML helpers. So that can also be created by creating a static class and extending the HTML helper interface or HTML helper class. So this is an example of how we can create a text box with the help of HTML helpers. So we having the @HTML, that is the instance of this HTML helper interface. Then we are calling here the method text box. Then we are passing here the text box name. So ultimately it is going to render a markup, and how that markup will look like. In the markup, you can see I have a specify. It is going to generate a markup with ID attribute as a name and name attribute also name. So it is setting the ID attribute value and it is setting the name attribute value, and value for the text box is empty over there. So this markup you don't need to generate yourself. It is taken care by this HTML helper text box. So this is the benefit of using the HTML helpers. So you don't need to type a lot of things. Just call the C# method and pass the necessary parameters and it automatically generate the things on the runtime for us. The next question is, what are the different types of HTML helpers we have in ASP.NET Core? So similar to the MVC 5, we having here built-in HTML helpers. Further, they can divide into standard HTML helpers. And standard HTML helper syntax is like this way, @HTML.textbox, then pass the textbox name as a string. We having the strong type helper, there we use the lambda expression. So in the lambda expression, we having a parameter. So here I am representing the model which we add at the top label to define the strongly type view, because the strongly type helper we use on the strongly type view. Then what are the property we having in that model? We define just next to this lambda operator. So this lambda operator is just a way to define the anonymous method. So if you're looking at the left hand side of this lambda operator is represent to the method parameters, and the right hand side is represent to the method body. So this is the way how we are using the lambda expression to create a anonymous method. So this is syntax for a strongly type helper we having. Then we having here templated HTML helpers. In the template HTML helper, we having the editor 4. So it is start with the editor word. Similar way, we having the editor 4 and the model 4, then define the model here along with the model property. It will automatically generate the text box markup for us. So starting from ASP.NET Core, HTML helpers are not the recommended one. I suggest you here you should go ahead with the tag helpers whenever you are going to generate the input control. So built-in HTML helper you can use only in that case wherever we don't have the alternative of that helper. Because still we don't have the alternative of some helpers in the tag helper. So there it is fine to go ahead with the built-in HTML helpers. Even you can create here your custom HTML helpers as well, as we can create in MVC file. And guys, one more thing to understand here, the ASP.NET Core is still supporting the HTML helpers so that you can easily migrate your MVC 5 application to the ASP.NET Core. Because it might be the case you having an application which you might build using the ASP.NET MVC 3, MVC 4 and MVC 5. Now you are willing to migrate to the ASP.NET Core MVC 5 or let's say ASP.NET Core MVC 6. How it can be done if we will not support the previous let's say existing markup? So this is also the benefit you will find out the support of HTML helpers in ASP.NET Core, so that the existing application we can migrate here without an issue. The next question is here, how to create a custom HTML helpers. So here we can create a custom HTML helpers by creating a static class. So here we create a static class named as custom helpers. Then we are extending the HTML helper interface that is available in ASP.NET Core. Then we are passing here other parameters like name I'm passing, value I'm passing. And if looking at the syntax of this method, it is a syntax for the extension method. So extension method we define inside a static class. And these are the special type of static method where we having the this keyword for that class and interface which we are going to extend. So here we are going to extend here the HTML helper interface. So that's why we are passing here this keyword. Then we are writing here a HTML markup. So here it is a string where we are just doing the string concatenation for the input type submit, value we having here, name we having here, and finally we need to return here HTML string. Because if you will return here this string as it is, so as per the Razor View Engine, it will not render it as a button. But as Razor View Engine will find out it's not a safe string to render. But when you will wrap it using the HTML string, the Razor View Engine consider it a safe string for us to render, or you can say to generate the button. So that's why we are using here HTML string as a return type. We are not using here as a normal string as a return type. So this is the way how we can create the custom HTML helper. And when it is coming to access, now you can access it smoothly as we access the others built-in HTML helper. So you can access here using the @HTML, then this method name submit button. Then do pass here first parameter as name. So here I'm passing the command as name here. Then value. So value I'm passing here create. So now it is a reusable helper. It can be reused at more than one places. So wherever you are willing to create the submit button, there this helper can be used now. The next question is here, what are the function blocks? So in ASP.NET Core, function blocks are the alternative of the inline helper. In ASP.NET MVC 5, we having the inline helpers, but here we don't have. So what are the alternative? We having the function blocks. So function blocks are just like C# method which returns to us HTML markup. Or you can say the methods where we writing the HTML markup to render it, we can create here with the help of function blocks. So function blocks are going to help us to reuse the HTML markup on the same page. So let's say you having a CSS HTML page and there you are willing to reuse a markup again and again. So you need to just create a function block, and the function block method should return the void. So it cannot have a return type, let's say string, let's say any other. It must have a return type as void, and you should try to make it async wherever it is possible. Now let's see how this look like. So this is the example here where I'm creating my function block, and here I'm just wrapping this code in a C# block. So C# block in Razor we can create using @ and curly braces, and this is the closing of this scope. Then I'm defining here a C# method and return type is void, and this mandatory to have the return type is void. ShowData is method where I'm having the array as a parameter. Then I'm using here a forEach statement so that I can repeat the li, and here in the li I'm using the item. What are the item we will pass? So objective is here I'm just willing to display the newly added code says here. So what I'm doing, I'm just calling a showData method, and the newly added code says array I'm passing here, let's say Python, AI, ML. Similarly, I can have another heading where I'm showing the most popular courses. There also you can pass the values, or you can have another heading also, let's say R courses. So in R courses also you can pass all the courses, whatever you are willing to display. So this is the way the same show data method markup we can reuse at more than one places, because this is the requirement of my UI. So whenever the UI you are willing to reuse at more than one places, and the almost UI design is same, so why not to create a reusable method? So this is the way how we are creating a function block for reusability purpose. The next question is here, what are the URL helpers? So obviously when you're dealing with the website or web page, we need to deal with the URL as well. So URL helpers actually renders the HTML link and row URLs, whatever we are going to use. So URL helper generate the links based upon the routing configuration. So whatever the convention based routing you have defined, whatever the attribute routing you have defined, based upon that it will generate the URL for us. So the benefit of URL helper, you will find out, instead of doing the hard code URL, use the URL helper. So this is the URL helper syntax, where I'm just calling the method URL action, then I'm passing the action name, then I'm passing the controller name. So here you don't need to do the hard code for the URL. We are now using the URL helper, and based upon the routing configuration, it will generate the things for us. The another example can be over there, you are having a jQuery AJAX method, where you need to figure out what URL we having for our controller action. So instead of doing the hard code URL over there, I can use the URL helper in the jQuery AJAX method on the CSHTML page, and we'll able to call my ASP.NET Core controller action method. So if you're looking at the overall benefit of the URL helpers, you will find out they are avoiding the hard coded URL. So whenever you are willing to avoid the hard code URLs, you should go ahead with the URL helpers. So next question is here, what are the tag helpers? So tag helpers allows server-side code to embed with the HTML element inside the razor files. So what are the HTML markup we having? Let's say we having HTML markup to create the login form, and inside the text box markup, we are willing to embed the C# server-side code, or let's say the server-side models, controller, and you know, let the action information. So how it can be done? It can be done with the help of tag helpers. So tag helper starts with ASP --, so that we able to include the model, action and controller information along with the tag. So this is the example here of the anchor tag, where I'm just integrating my action as login. So it is starting with ASP --action. Then we having your ASP --controller, then passing your controller name. Then this is the link text. So it automatically generate the href attribute for this anchor tag when it will be compiled by the Razor View engine. So Razor View engine is smart enough to read this tag helpers and to generate the appropriate attribute for this anchor tag. And the tag helpers returns in the C# and target the HTML elements based upon the element name, based upon the element attribute name and the parent tag. So the Razor View engine is smart enough. So based upon this setting, the Razor View engine automatically target the attribute for the anchor tag. The Razor View engine automatically specify the name, attribute value, the ID attribute value, if the similar syntax you are writing for the text box. Because in the text box we use ASP-4, where we mention the model property, like for which property we are going to create the text box. So tag helpers support the more HTML friendly development experience, because before the tag helpers, the development experience was not the HTML friendly, because there we need to write the C# code. And if you are working with the UI team, or let's say the designer, which don't know about the .NET anything, so the designer, to working with the designer, the things were difficult. Even sometimes it takes a lot of time to change the markup handover by the designer UI team, because the UI team or the designer always handover the things in plain HTML. So that plain HTML, we have to complete change with the HTML helpers in MVC 5 and in MVC 4 and 3. But in ASP.NET Core, the things are now simplified. Just use the as-it-is mockup provided by the UI team, the designer, and just integrate your server-side code using the tag helper. So using the tag helper, I can define the model property using ASP.4, and I can define the link as well, let's say ASP.NET section and ASP.NET controller. So the development time also will reduce if we will use the tag helper now. So this is about the tag helper you should know. The next question is, what are the various tag helpers are available in ASP.NET Core? So ASP.NET Core supporting a rich set of tag helpers. So this is the list I'm sharing with you. So we having a tag helpers for creating a form. We having a tag helper for defining the form action. We having a tag helper for the input control. We having a tag helper for label. We having tag helper for anchor tag, image, drop down list, text area for displaying the validation error messages using the span. We having a tag helper for validation summary so that we can display the list of errors as a list. We having a tag helper to render the partial view. We having a tag helper for rendering the script, the external script. We having a tag helper for the link. We having a tag helper for the cache tag. We having the link tag also. We having a tag helper to render a component view. We having tag helper for the distributed cache. We having a tag helper to specify the environment specific setting. So if you're working in a specific environment, let's say development environment, testing environment, and the production environment. So specific to the environment, if you're willing to render the static content, so it can be done over there. So these various tag helpers are offered by the ASP.NET Core. So depending upon your requirement, you can use one of them so that you can now work in the HTML friendly markup. Even you can improve your development experience as well, along with the productivity. Question answer about caching, bundling, and minification. So first question is here, what is caching? So caching provides a way for storing the frequently accessed data in memory and reusing that. So ultimately, whatever the data is shared by all the users of the website, we, instead of fetching it from the database, we can store it in the cache so that we can access it fastly as compared to the accessing it from the database. Because when you're going to query the database, it takes time because the query execution is happening over there. But if the data is already the part of cache, it is accessible easily and it takes less time. So caching is an effective way for improving the web application performance. If you're looking for improving your web application performance where you having a lot of content and shared, you should use always cache over there. And when it is coming to the cache strategy in ASP.NET Core, we having the in-memory cache option, we having the response cache, and we having the distributed cache. So depending upon the requirement, you can use one of them. And if you're looking at the example of what are the various websites which are using the cache, if you're looking at the Stack Overflow, the question and answer, so everything is coming from the cache. If you're looking at the .netx.com, so what are the articles, what are the courses you're accessing over there, we keeping them in the cache. So benefit of this approach is we don't need to fetch the articles and the courses again and again from the database. It is coming from the memory. So it can be decided whether you are storing that content in the application memory, whether you are going to cache the content in the application browser, whether you are going to cache the content in a distributed cache like Redis cache, we have the option over there. The next question is here, what are the advantages of caching? So caching reduces the hosting server and the database server round trips. So instead of calling the database server again and again, and instead of accessing always the content from the hosting server, it is going to be accessed either from the application memory, if it is a database things, if it is a cache the content in the browser label, so it will be served from the browser. So when the content is cached at the client side, or it calls the minimum request to the server. If let's say you are having the some static images, are we having the static content like a JavaScript file and the CSS file, so these things we can easily cache at the browser level. So benefit of this approach is it will not call to the hosting server again and again for requesting this static content. So obviously it will reduce the round trip on the hosting server. The similar thing we can do here with the database server as well. So database server content we can cache in the Redis cache, that is a part of the distributed cache, or either I can store it in the application memory. So whenever you are willing to fetch that content, so it will serve from the Redis cache, either it will serve from the application in memory. The next benefit you will find out, it reduce the network traffic, because when the content is cached at the client side. So unnecessary, you're not going to retrieve all the static content information from the hosting server. It is going to serve from the browser itself. Even the same thing we have implemented in the .NETX as well, where what are the images we are using in articles, what are the various images we are using at the course level. These are coming from the cache because we having a cache duration over there. Similar thing you will find out in the Facebook, you will find out in the Twitter and various others are the platform. What they are doing, they are also caching the images. Another benefit you will find out, it avoid the time consumption for regenerating the reusable content. So obviously, it also reduce the what are the time is taken to regenerate the reusable content, because everything is available from the browser itself, so it is done easily. So the ultimate goal of using the cache is to boost the application performance. But here you have to note down one point here. We only cache that content that is shared by the multiple users of a website. If a content is exclusive to a particular user, then we never cache that content. Remember it. The next question is how to implement the response and memory cache in ASP.NET Core. So in ASP.NET Core, we can implement the response cache by decorating our action using the response cache attribute. So if you're looking at in this picture, I'm just using here the response cache attribute, and here I'm using the very Y header. It is going to store in the client side because I have mentioned a user agent, and this is the duration. So for 30 seconds, we are just going to store it in the client side. When it is coming to the memory cache, for memory cache, we having here iMemory cache interface, that instance you can create. Then we can inject it at the controller constructor. This is the way how the injection we are doing. This is the way the initialization is happening. Now using this memory cache, you need to just create here a key first of all. Now we have a method get or create key. So this get or create key method will try to fetch the existing key if it is already available. But if it is not available, it will create a new one. So this is the key I'm passing here. This is the data we are just going to store over there. So we having the get data method, which will return us the data. And this is the sliding expiration. So this is the time span where I'm just going to store the data. So we are just going to store the data for the 15 minutes. So this is the way how the memory cache we can use to cache the content in the application memory. And this is the way how can response the cache in the browser end. The next question is here, what is the bundling and minification? So bundling and minification are the important part of a web application when you're going to load are the various CSS file and the various JavaScript file. So benefit of this approach is the bundle will group the static files like CSS and the JavaScript, which are going to be loaded now in a single HTTP request. If let's say you having the 10 CSS file and that lets it 10 JavaScript file. So instead of making the 20 requests to the server, what we can create a one bundle for CSS file. We can create a one bundle for the JavaScript file. So the 20 requests will reduce to only 2 HTTP requests, because now we have created a bundle, one bundle for CSS, another bundle for the JavaScript. So depending upon your requirement, you can create the n number of bundles. But benefit is here, instead of having the let's say 10 and 20 requests to the server, we will have now 1 or 2 requests on the server, let's say few requests to the server. So when it is coming to the minification, so minification is a technique for removing the unnecessary characters which we commonly write when we're writing the code in the Delemon machine. So what the unnecessary characters we have? We have the white spaces, we have the new line, we have the tab. So ultimately we format the things. Even we have the comments also, and the JavaScript code label and the CSS code label. So these unnecessary going to occupy the space for that file. So if you will remove these unnecessary characters, so what will happen? The size of the file will reduce. So this is the benefit you will find out of minification. So minification goal is to reduce the file size so that when it will travel into the network, so it will use the less bandwidth and it will be rendered fastly into the browser. So both bundling and minification reduce the number request as well as reduce the size of the request, so that it will help us to improve our web page loading time. So now the web page will load faster as compared to the previous one after implementing the bundling and minification. The next question is here, how to create a bundle for CSS and the JavaScript file in ASP.NET Core. So in ASP.NET Core, if you are using the Visual Studio, we having a extension bundler and minification. So this is a very useful extension from the Madden's Christians. So this extension you can download from the Visual Studio gallery, and after installing it in your Visual Studio, you'll be able to bundle your CSS file, you'll be able to bundle your JavaScript file. If you're looking at, this is the way how you can bundle my CSS file. So multiple CSS file reference you can add here, separated by comma, and it will create a one bundle for the CSS. Similar way, I can add here multiple JavaScript file here, like library, and it will create a one bundle over there. So you can see I'm just importing here jQuery bootstrap and the jQuery cookie, and finally it's creating a bundle for jQuery. So instead of making three different requests, now we are making only one request for loading all the jQuery library. Similar way for making the two separate requests for the CSS, now we are making the one. So the five requests which we made, three for JS and two for the CSS, we have reduced to only two. Similar way, you can have the other use cases as well, where the number requests can be reduced by the bundling and minification will help us to reduce the size of the file as well. The next question is how to implement the HTML minification. So far we talk about how we can implement the minification at the CSS file level and the JavaScript file level. Do we have any way to minify our HTML markup as well, which we are using on our HTML web page to display the content? So yeah, we having the option over there. So we having the web markup min ASP.NET Core 5 NuGet package. So what are the version you are using? If you are using the ASP.NET Core 3, just use ASP.NET Core 3. If you are using 5, we having 5. If you are using 6, we having the 6. So depending upon your ASP.NET Core version, you can download the web markup min package. After that, in the startup class, we having the configure services method. In the configure services method, you need to just configure this web markup min like this way. So here I can define my HTML minification rule. So as per the minification rule, it will remove the redundant attributes. It will minify the inline JavaScript code. It will minify the inline CSS code, or what we commonly write at the HTML element label. So this is the way how the whatever the HTML are we having on the web page, what are the JavaScript code we wrote over there, what are the CSS we wrote over there, it will minify everything. And in the last, we are just compressing our HTTP response as well. So this is the way the web markup min can help us to minify our HTML markup, or you can say our web page HTML markup. It is also help us to reduce the web page size and it will render faster. Apart from the web markup min, you can use other NuGet package as well, depending upon your requirement. But I prefer this package because I already tested it in the .NETX.com. There also we have used the same package. The next one we have here, what is CDN? So CDN is a distributed network of server that is going to serve the static content from the different server available across the globe. So it is going to help us to serve the JavaScript file, the CSS file, which is from the different edge server. So benefit is that these edge server are distributed to the different geography across the globe. If let's say somebody is accessing your website from India, so what are the edge server of the CDN we have in India that will serve the static content? If let's say somebody is accessing your website from US, so what are the edge server we having in the US that will serve the content? And if somebody is accessing your content from the Europe, so what are the edge server we having in the Europe that will serve the content? So benefit is here, the content will be served from the nearby location and it will help us to reduce the latency. So this is the benefit you will find out. So because of the reducing the latency, our website will render fastly into that particular geography location user. So the CDN offers the high bandwidth content to the user by caching them across the globe. So what is happening? What are the content you are having? That content is going to cache across the globe with the help of these edge server. And whenever there is a requirement to update it, that cache you can update. And after that, these edge server will have the latest content. So whenever a particular user is accessing your content from a particular region, so the edge server available in that region, it's a nearby to that region, will serve the content. And because of that, your website will render fastly that static content. So it reduces the load from the application server, since the static content will load faster from the CDN. So the thing is, the benefit you will find out, like instead of putting this static content in your hosting machine, now you are going to serve it from the edge server. Because you might having the audio, video, even already the platform which you find out across the globe, which are using the audio and video, they never keep the entire content on the application server. They always keep the content on the CDN, because CDN help them to cache the content and serve them in less time to a particular region user. So this is the way how the CDN is going to help us to improve our application performance. It is very, very important from the perspective of those website who having the huge static content like images, document, audio, video. So for those website, CDN is very important. Question answer about inversion of control and dependency. So let's start with the first question, like what is dependency? So let's take the example of class A and the class B. So let's say class A having a dependency on the class B to perform its job. Now let's take the example of class A and class B. Let's say class A need the class B object to do its job. So in that case, the class B would be the dependency for class A. And if we look at the another example of dependency, let's say we having the application layers, so which also having the dependency on each other, like presentation layer having the dependency on the bell layer, and the bell layer having the dependency on the data access layer. Similar way, you might use other external services and the component dependency. Let's say you might be using web services, you might be using third party components, like you might be using any payment gateway API, let's say Paytm, PayUmoney, or let's say Razorpay, like PayPal. So these are also the dependency for our application. Now next question is here, how to manage the dependency? For understanding the dependency management, now let's go back to the example of class A and the class B, where class A using the class B object to manage, to do its job. So in that case, class A having the three options. What these three options is here? The first option is simple, straightforward, do create class B object. The second option is here, like you can fetch the class B object from somewhere, like you can have a method. When you will call that method can return the class B object. But in the first two cases, class A actually is in the control of its dependency, because class A has to do something. It is just like, let's say you are having your own birthday, and you know on birthday you are willing to purchase a mobile phone. So one option is here, you can purchase the mobile phone yourself by going into the market. And another option is here, just order it online and they will deliver that smartphone at your home. But in the both the cases, you are putting your effort, you are putting your money over there. But there is a one more option here. Let's say you will receive that mobile phone automatically. Let's say your friend, your family members, somebody is giving you that mobile phone as a gift. So at that time, you are not putting any effort over there. You are just receiving it whenever it is required. So this third style of managing the dependency actually comes under inversion of control. You see, because in this third case, you are not doing anything, but you are getting that thing also, which is required to you. So same thing we having at the code level also. In the code level, whenever we need the dependency, that time would be provided. So that is known as the ICE inversion of control dependency management. Now let's move to the next question, like what is inversion of control? So inversion of control is a programming style where the flow of a program has been inverted, or you can say it has been changed from the normal way. Because if we look at the previous example, class A and the class B. So class A, in first two cases, putting some effort for creating or like getting the class B object. But in the third case, class A is not doing anything. It will retrieve it automatically. So that third way is actually known as the IOC, because in the third way, you are changing the flow of the program from normal way. So ultimately, who is responsible to provide the class B object? So there is a runtime library or framework which will create the dependency object and will provide to you, or you can say will provide to the class A whenever the class A needed that dependency. So now let's understand what are the various inversion of control mechanisms we are having. So IOC can be implemented by using different mechanisms. Let's say we have been the service locator pattern, we have been the event, we have been the delegates, and we have been the dependency injection. So these are the various style to implement the IOC, because so far whatever we are discussing, it is a theory. Because I said it's a programming style. So when you say style, a style means it is a theory, it's not an implementation. So implementation for IOC are either service locator pattern, event, delegate, and dependency injection. Now let's move to the next question. What are the advantages of IOC? So IOC make the code loosely coupled, because now the class, you don't need to create the class B object itself. It is going to be provided on the runtime. And when the things are going to be offered at the runtime, it will make the things loosely coupled. Allow for more reusability also. So now the code reusability would be increased, because now your code can be used with, let's say, multiple payment gateway API. Now let's say if you are injecting the payment gateway service on the runtime, so you will be able to use the multiple payment gateway APIs over there. It is making the code unit testing, because ultimately for writing the unit test cases, your code should be loosely coupled. If your code is not loosely coupled, you cannot write the unit test cases. So these are the main advantages of implementing the IOC. Even the same thing you will find out when you will implement the dependency in your application, because IOC is a theory, DI is the implementation. Question answer about the filters. So what are the filters in ASP.NET Core? So when it is coming to the filter, say filter is an attribute class which methods are going to be executed before or after an action is executed, or I can say being executed. So filters are used to perform the following common functionalities. So the filters are helpful to implement the authentication, where we can check the user logged in detail, whether the user is logged in or not into a system. And we can check the authorization. So authorization is about checking the permission, checking the role. So here such code we can write here, then we can write here the we can perform the error handling or logging. So if there is a requirement, we need to capture some error which is going to be thrown by the action execution. So those can be captured over there. Even we can log the activity also. So activity logging can be done, data caching can be done over there. Because sometimes there is a requirement, we are willing to cache the data into the browser label. So how we can add the cache header with the response, so that this response will be cached in the browser, so that code can also be done. Even we can write the code for data compression. So what are the response is prepared by the action result, and the response, let's say, are willing to compress it. So such code can also be wrote over there. So the filter is nothing. Filter is just an attribute class which we can place at the action label, at the controller label, to perform these common set of operation, or you can do the other operation as well, depending upon your requirement. The next question here, what are the different types of filters in ASP.NET Core? So in ASP.NET Core, we have been the authorization filter, resource filter, action filter, exception filter, and result filter. And these are the various filters we are having, and they are going to be executed in the same order as I wrote over there. So first, the authorization filter is going to be executed, then resource filter, then action filter, then exception filter, then result filter. Even if you will look at the ASP.NET Core request pipeline, which we discussed in the previous video, you will understand it. In the same order I wrote over there, and in the same order they are going to be executed. Now the next question is here, how to create a custom filter? So we can also create our own custom filter to implement one of the objective like authentication, logging, we having the error handling like for various other purpose. So in ASP.NET Core, a custom filter can be created by implementing the ASP.NET Core filter interfaces. So ASP.NET Core providing us the various filter interfaces. So we having the iAuthorization filter interface, we having the iAction filter interface, we having the iResult filter interface, we having the iException filter interface. So by implementing this interface, we can write the code to create a custom authorization filter, to create a custom action filter, to create a custom result filter, to create a custom exception filter over there. So custom filters are used to inject your own logic before or after an action is going to be executed. Or you can say whatever the logic which you are willing to call before executing an action and after executing an action. So that logic can be wrote here with the help of one of the filter type over there. So when it is coming to create your own custom filter, so this is the way how you can create a custom filter for the authorization purpose. So what I'm doing here, I'm just going to inherit this attribute class, the C# attribute class, because what are the attribute you are willing to create in the C#, that attribute class must inherit the attribute. Then I'm using here the iAuthorization filter. This is the interface which I'm going to implement it. So this interface containing this method onAuthorization. So in this onAuthorization method, I can write the code for authentication purpose. Then I can write the code for authorization purpose, and I can take the decision to based upon whether the user is logged in or not, or whether the user having the permission or not. So this is the way your custom authorization filter you can create. Similar, we can create the custom action filter, custom result filter, and other types of filters as well. The next question is here, how to configure filters in ASP.NET Core. So filters we can configure at the three levels. So what are these three levels? We can configure the filters at global level, means the filter which you are willing to call across the application, that can be configured in the startup class. So in the startup class, we having the configure services method, and inside the configure services method, we use this call. Let's say add controllers with views. If you are using the ASP.NET Core 3.1 and the 5.0, so starting from 3.0, we use add controllers with views. But if you are using the ASP.NET Core 1.0 and the 2.0, there we having a method add MVC. So there it can be added. So here I'm just going to call my custom filter, or you can say I'm just going to add my custom filter using this options.filters.add. This is the how we can configure my filter at global level. The second we having here at controller level. So you can configure your filter at controller level as well. So it's simple, what are the attribute you created, just define at the controller level. So you can see I'm having here admin controller, and I just added here my authorize filter. So authorize is a built-in attribute where I'm just checking for whether the user having the admin role or not. So this is the filter I just configured at controller level. Similar way, your custom filter also can be added here at controller level. It's up to you. The next option we have in here, action label. We can also register the filter at action label. So you might having the action where you're looking for any filters. So here I can apply a filter at action label. So you can see I'm just going to authorize this filter for login user 1 and user 2 over there. It can be any condition, it's up to you. So here we added the filters at action label. Here we added the filter at controller label. So benefit of the controller label filter is whatever the action you will define now in this controller. So this filter will applicable to all the action. But when it is coming the action label, so this is going to be executed only for one action, not for all the action defined in this user controller. And when it is coming to the global filter, so this filter is going to applicable to all controllers and all actions in our application.